this point, maybe we should just go ahead and let
Miss Dee Wallace come out.
Let's give it up.
You know, obviously, we've said this before, you get recognized here, everybody knows who you are, but out on the street, who do you get recognized to be most? Do they say, oh, you're the mom from E.T., oh, you're that werewolf chick?
Gabby's mom. Are you Gabby's mom? That's what I get most. You know, it depends on where you're at. Disneyland, definitely E.T. Work conventions, it's reading more than the horror stuff. So, just depends on where you're at. Who gravitates where, you know? Unfortunately, I have a very large spectrum.
It's true, it's very true. I like those earrings, those are cute.
Thank you. It's for Ross.
Ooh.
A friend came out, one of the people that I do a lot of speaking engagements with, and she had them on and went, oh my God, those are such dear earrings, I've got to get some. And she said, okay, here.
You're that kind of person.
Took them off and handed
them
to me, so now I pay it forward.
Well, here's the thing. We obviously, you don't have to suck up to us because we're horror fans or anything, but what do you enjoy getting recognized for most? Is there one role that you're actually really touched when people bring up to you?
Shoot that scene between Dudley and I called my agent at the last minute because I could literally see my grandmother rolling over in her grave or hanging herself at the time. And if I had to do nudity, they said, well, no, they'd have to put it in your contract, Dee, if you have to do nudity. I mean, that's how green it was. So off we go to Las Altas, Mexico, and get ready to do this scene. And I'm sitting on the bed, and Blake comes over, and he goes, how do you feel about doing this nude? Well, my Kansas, you know, everything closed up, my heart went, But I faked it really well. And I said, Mr. Edwards, I think it's really bad for the car. I mean, I don't think after he couldn't get it up, she should flaunt it in front of the States, right? And, you know, everybody else in the picture is nude. And I make my living doing commercials now, so if you want to guarantee me two more pictures, I guess I could try. He took a beat and went, okay, just thought I'd ask. And he was so smart because he knew that that would take me into that vulnerable, frightened place that Mary Lewis needed to be. And, you know, we learned the lines, but working with Dudley Moore, I mean, it was like, just hang on, because you never knew where the hell he was going to go. Right? I mean, the fall over of the bed, into the bed, over the thing, that wasn't in there. Thank God I was in shape again, right? And we finished the first shot, and Blake would watch a monitor on the other side of the stage, and nobody spoke after a shot until Blake said it. And so we finished the shot and waited. All of a sudden we heard, well, I don't know who the fuck wrote it, but we're going to print it. And of course he'd written it, but we had just got all over the place. And then 3 months later, they called and asked if I would come back because Blake wanted to take me into the bathroom. We didn't originally shoot that at all. So I have a lot of stories about being called back, like Rob Zombie wants to kill you better. I think I told you that story the other night. So.
Out of curiosity, you've spoken about how, you know, you're a dancer, and obviously that's helped you a lot in different roles that were, you know, ended up being innately physical, but when in your career did you decide, okay, acting is, that's what my career is going to be? When did you know that was?
When my dance teacher told me I was great, I was good, but I could never be great, and I better decide to focus on something else. I was a soloist in a ballet company in Kansas City. I was a very big fish in a very little pond. But you know, I'm built like a gymnast, and I was never going to go much further. I danced on Broadway and did, I can't tell you how many industrials. I danced, I have to show you. This is how I went from Los Angeles from New York to Los Angeles across the country. Tie it together.
I'm sorry.
Kugel peanut butter. Okay. It was chocolate and peanut butter in one thing, right? So we had these hot pink, very high cut little outfits on. Pink satin with these big eyes. Because the jar had big eyes. I have no idea why the jar had eyes. But we had big eyes all over us, right? And we did this whole little thing, and it had fringe on the bottom. I actually just found a picture of me and the other girl. And we traveled across America doing this industrial, and it was something like, wait a minute, Kugel peanut with the cuckoo-cuckoo.
I mean, obviously a lot of the people that are sitting here today, you know, we know you from the horror films you're in. So when you were handed the first script that was a genre flick or a horror flick, did you read it and say, I don't know if I should do this?
No, I read it and went, fuck, good job. was actually a religious film called All the King's Horses that I did for Mark Four Pictures. And that's before video, before DVDs. And I became so close with the director, whom I'm still good friends with today. And I said, Don, is there any way that you can get the film out here so I can invite agents, because maybe I can get an agent with this film? So of course, he loaded up all the cans and flew out with the cans for me. And everybody I talked to said, are you joking? You can't invite agents from Hollywood to watch a religious film. They'll freaking laugh you out of, you know. I said, look, I'm proud of my work in this, and if they can't see what I do, whether it's a religious film or not, then I don't want them as an agent. So I invited 10 of the top agents that I thought were big enough to do something for me and small enough to actually come. And they all came and they watched the film, and 9 of them gave me offers. So that's, you know, I from the healer point of me, I really want to throw that out to you, that seriously, you're your highest answer. If you get a hit to do something, then you better follow through and do it, because everybody's going to mirror your fear back to you. And you get to go, oh, yeah, well, that's my shit, and I'm going to rise above it and just go on and do it anyway.
As far as, you know, obviously, from your start there, and forgive me if I'm wrong about this, was The Howling the first horror film you did, or am I completely blanking on something?
That would be The Hills Have Eyes.
Oh my God, yes, of course. It's gonna be boring. I'm not gonna lie, that movie freaks me out. I have trouble watching The Hills Have Eyes.
So that pretty much freaks me out.
It really
freaked me out to do it.
Now, were you skeeved out when you first read that script, or was it exciting? Because it was so salacious.
It was a job. Let me reiterate. It's a job, and it was the lead part, right? And since then, not much, but sometimes I remember, oh my God, it's going to be in the desert. Oh my God. Or you have to run around in the snow in a bikini, Dee. You know? Never focus on all those little things, because for me anyway, as soon as I read a script, you know, now I just say to my agents, if they don't have any money and they really don't want me to do it, don't send me the script, because once I read it, you know, the part goes, take me.
You know you want to do me.
it's kind of like a sexual union once you read a part that you really want to do. And so you go, okay, well, I can freeze to death for 3 weeks, or I can fight rabid dogs for, you know, what was it, 8? I think we did it in 8 weeks, 2 months, something like that. Oh my God, Cujo just about killed me, literally. They treated me for exhaustion afterwards, blew my adrenals clean out. Because, you know, I don't know if you know this, as an actor, when you go through fight or flight scenes, your body doesn't know you're acting. So the chemical adjustments that your body makes in real life, in real traumatic situations, happen to you when you're shooting. So you have to be really conscious now. I mean, I wasn't during Cujo, but I am now, to kind of redirect your body and go, okay, it was just play, I'm really all right, so come back into balance. Yeah.
Now, the things that I've read about Cujo, and you can correct me if I'm wrong.
I will.
I know you will. it wasn't actually hot in the car. It was freezing. Yeah.
We were freezing. It was Northern California in November. I finally had him put a little heater in the front of the car. They figured out how to rig a heater. in the front of the car because Danny and I were just, you know. And then it was like, well, we have to spray you down and make you look hot. So, because I hate glycerin, I think it looks really fake and it feels even worse, believe me. So, yeah, we're good, aren't we? Did you really think?
Oh yeah, you look like you're sweating your face off.
I know.
Now, did you feel sort of a mothering vibe towards Danny?
Oh yeah.
I mean, all the time.
Kids that I work with.
Yeah.
Why do you think I've done so many freaking?
I know.
You know, and I didn't have kids. I didn't have kids when I did ET or Cujo or, and the press, they're so funny, you know, because they always want to catch you on stuff. You know, well, what kind of preparation did you do? Because you don't have any children. I said, no, but I had a mother. We all know how to mother. We mother dogs, don't we, and cats, and you know, it's a hard thing. If you love somebody, you rush to protect them. I'm still, my daughter's 24. Everybody, a little commercial. She's coming out in her first big film, so I want you to support it. It's called Speak No Evil. Does anybody know Rose and his work yet? Oh, you will. Okay, Rose Films, R-O-Z-E. Okay.
Well, now we'll be looking for it.
You're going to think you're looking at a mini D.
That's what I was curious of, yeah. And you're talking about Louis T. being are you still friends with Louis T.?
Like, I am, actually. I just got an email from him. Yesterday.
And how was your experience with that? Is that the only project you've worked with him on?
Well, you know, we started out with, and you're going to ask me the guy's name, and I'm not. He did the ruling class. Who did the ruling class? Who directed it? Yeah, well, anyway. He was our first director on Cujo, and I got to the set, and we started shooting some kind of basic things and discussing, and he wanted me to be in all these see-through tops without any underwear, and the scene, he wanted to do kind of a graphic new scene. I mean, I could have done it with Chris, but I wouldn't have. And I went to Dan Black, and I went, this isn't the film I signed on for. This is a film about a mother's love and protection for her son. I'm not going to be nude in this film, and I'm not going to wear... And he looked at me and went, who the hell told you that? And I went, okay, have we had any production meetings here at all? The right hand know it, and he was gone in 3 days. And Louis T., God bless him, he had originally been sent the script and done some kind of preliminary work on it. And he came, literally came in 4 days into it and took it over. And between he and our DP, I mean, they just were an amazing team and saved the whole thing. And thank God for Danny Pintaro, because if I'd had a kid that couldn't act, we would have all been screwed. And thank God for Carl Miller, who trained five real dogs were used in Cujo. They were all trained to go after toys. So on action, he'd go, dig for your toys! So they'd go, right? And that's how they got them so ferocious. Of course, we had to shoot really fast, because all this crap was egg white. You know, and the dogs would just be licking them up on delicious good. And fake blood and all that stuff. We had to actually tie their tails down with fish wire. There's a couple of shots in there that you can actually see the dog's tail wagging, but they felt like it kind of worked for that particular shot. We had a hell of a time. It took us 2 days because none of the St. Bernards would go through the window, that end scene. So we had a black lab that they put the St. Bernard suit on. Well, that was a drastic failure. Then we tried to use the stuntman. If you look at my table, there's a great shot of Louis Teague and I and the stunt guy.
Dancing?
That was even more dreadful. So finally, we got one of the big St. Bernards. It's such an amazing shot at the end, you know, when he comes through that in slow motion. Oh my God, when you think he's dead. Oh, he's so powerful. But it took us a lot of time.
Did you ever have any bad experiences with any of the dogs, or were outside of when they were, you know, acting? They were all friendly.
No, we weren't allowed to have any contact with the dogs unless we were doing a scene with them, which was very hard for me because I love dogs, and I really wanted to pet and love on them all the time, but we weren't allowed to. Same thing when I did the new Lassie, although there wasn't much to communicate with in the new Lassie. They found this dog, and they could prove that it was a real descendant of Lassie, but it had been a house pet all its life, and Weatherwax had, I think, 3 months to... That freaking dog couldn't do shit. Not do anything. We did this whole, the first day of shooting, we had this whole huge, amazing scene about these dirty socks, and I filmed to Chris, and Chris moved, Scott, you know, and then the end was Scott picks him up and throws him to Lassie. Well, we shot the whole scene, and then we brought the dog in, and Weatherwax says, oh no, you can't throw anything at Lassie. It scares him. Again, did we not have a production meeting on any of it? Right? There was this huge Lassie episode about basketball. Well, you can't bounce balls around Lassie, so Lassie can't be in any of those scenes. I mean, it was, got to be a joke, really. Let's write a series about a dog who can't do anything. But he was a real descendant, and that's all they needed for publicity.
It was the bloodline.
Yeah.
Now, I want to do some jumping around, talking about different films that everybody wants to hear about, but I'm going to be selfish for a minute. Let's talk about the movie Popcorn. Any Popcorn fans here? Now, here's the thing. I mean, the God's honest truth. I have yet, from any of the people I've ever spoken to about this film, I have not really heard one good story about...
Yeah, there aren't many.
Yeah, so I was curious if you could talk about all the horrible stuff that was happening behind the scenes. And you can be honest, because everybody else has been so far too.
Well, I think we got closed down 4 times because they didn't know if they had the money. We shot in Jamaica in this god-awful abandoned theater that you could tell, seriously, a lot of people had urinated in. In the worst part of Jamaica, I mean, we changed producers and directors a number of times. How many people know why I'm a brunette in that film?
No, I don't know.
Because I just had my baby and I was breastfeeding and I couldn't color my hair.
Oh, I did not know that.
So here we are, we're schlepping, you know, this, like, how old was Gabby? Well, I was still breastfeeding, so she had to be like, you know, under 4 months. Oh, I just told you how old I breastfed. Don't tweet it! So we're schlepping her and formula and pumping shit and all this stuff. And Chris is with me. Thank God Chris is with me because, you know, Chris was my soulmate, my rescuer, a lot in life. And, oh, shit. So, I must be tired. I can usually pull it back. So anyway, he was there, and it was just one fiasco. Oh, so I'm in this body cast, right? And this big scene in this body cast is going to take at least a day to shoot. And I get there, and they say, well, we had you come early because we have to wrap you in all the stuff and everything. I said, say what? Well, I said, yeah, you're just gonna wrap me in the cast? You don't have a cast made that you can open up or something? Oh, yeah, that would have been a good idea. I said, well, how do you pee or anything. If I'm wrapped in it, no. And so they actually figured out how to cut it and put a hinge on it so I could get in and out of this. Seriously. Sometimes I think I should direct myself. OMG. It was just, yeah. But after that, we took a family vacation. We went to Ocho Rios.
Oh, very nice.
Which is, oh, heaven. And had a lovely family vacation. So that's kind of what I choose to remember about shooting popcorn. Yeah.
Is it weird for you when you get cast in a movie where you're not that much older than the person that you're playing mother to?
Like, would that be my entire
is it just, you know, it's work for you, it doesn't feel weird?
No, you just commit to the part, you know? I mean, there are a lot of people that have babies at 17 and 18, so I just go there, as opposed to me who had one at 40.
Now, as far as, you know, with popcorn, was there anything, I've read the original shooting script, and it differs very much from what actually happened.
Pretty much every original script that you will ever read differs considerably from what you're going to see. The first cut of 10 that we had, 4 hours and 50-some minutes was his first cut. Yeah, well, Blake was famous for shooting too much. So, all I can tell you is after you go through, yeah, me too. After you go through 3 directors and 2 producers and, you know, and you have to understand, you get to the set and they go, shit, we're behind, what can we cut? I mean, that's rampant on a lot of sets these days. We lost a lot of Rob Zombie's stuff because we just didn't, in Lords of Salem, we just didn't have time. You know, he was financing this all himself and we were. Do you know that everybody in that picture worked for scale? Yeah, just because we love Rob and we wanted to support him in doing his own thing. But that's like unheard of these days. You know, it's really unheard of. Actors just don't do that. But he got all of us. It's so funny, my agent called me and she said, well, Rob Zombie wants you for his new film. And he wrote the part for you. And it's scale. Fuck. I said, what? She said, well, he's doing it all himself and he's asking everybody. I said, across the board, everybody's working for scale. And she said, well, we're waiting on you. No pressure. I said, dude, I'm in, you know, because I just love Rob. I just love him.
Well, that actually leads into the next sort of line of questioning. If you could just talk about your work with Rob. Was there ever a time when, you know, you got to sit down and sort of have a meeting with him before you were cast in Halloween and that sort of thing?
I didn't say hi to him until, well, let's see. I think when I went to get wardrobe, he was there. And we met, said hi. And I mean, Lords of Salem, he, you know, I did that beastie thing for him too, the voiceover. What's that called, you guys?
The Counting World of Super Beast.
Yeah, and he called me and said, Dee, you want to come in and do the voice of this she-wolf for me? And I said, well, what's it about? He said, well, there's these 3 she-devils, or 3 werewolf she-wolves, and, you know, I mean, there's a lot of sex and shit in it. And I said, can I be the one with the biggest boobs? He said, okay. So where were we? Sorry, I got dressed.
Well, also, I mean, with Lords of Salem.
No, I didn't see Rob about Lords of Salem. I mean, we emailed a couple of times, but.
So you've got Rob Zombie's email?
How much is it worth?
Well, the you know, with Lords of Salem, I'm not going to see you play against Ted because we've seen you now as evil and sweet, and we can't really distinguish the two anymore.
See,
Hansel
and Gretel.
Oh, really?
That's so much fun playing that
with. But with Lords of Salem, if for anybody who hasn't seen it, I mean, you're a pretty badass bitch. You're like, oh, hi, cute. Let me just beat you to death with a frying pan. So, I mean, do Do you enjoy more being the bad woman? Do you like that? Is it cathartic?
Again, I want to work.
Actually, yeah, I do. I like playing, I mean, I would love to play somebody really whacked out again. You know, at the beginning of my career, I played some really demented, I mean, mentally sick women. And you have to understand, when I was at the height of my career, all the movies of the week, that's what we did, that's what was going on. And so you got to play battered wives and alcoholics and, you know, all the movie of the week genre kind of roles. That's my stuff. You know, Sweet Moms, yeah, I can do Sweet Moms really well. It gets kind of boring after a while, quite frankly. And I have a really beautiful film that actually Gabrielle and I, my daughter's name is Gabrielle Stone, that's who she goes by, are doing together. It got hired separately.
Really?
How interesting is that? And everybody thinks that, like I said, I do that now. Anyway, it's called the Elephant's Graveyard that we're doing in September. And I get to play a woman who's dying of cancer. And to those of you who are asking, no, I've never died of cancer, so I don't really know what it is. I get that question all the time, like, do you go down when you have to play a hooker and study, you know, do you become a hooker for 2 weeks? No. I know how to get five stones. I can fight a lot in my life. What was the question?
I don't even remember now.
Sometimes I watch these things and I go, seriously, that came out of your mouth.
Like yesterday.
What did you see? It's my DNA!
What? Remember yesterday when we yelled at it? It was awesome.
Kind of, oh, cut. Look, let me tell you. I was supposed to be this cutie doll all the way through Lords of Salem. Right? And then we did the scene because he wanted the first of it just, you know, we're playing roles, we're faking it, right? So, I was supposed to be this cute little kid. So, after we gave her to Satan, Sunny went, I'm not fucking doing this anymore. I'm not doing this charade anymore. And this is what happens to me. Seriously. The part tells me, I don't tell the part. And I'm going, with that information. So we went to Rob and we're getting ready to shoot the next scene and we're always don't have enough time and I go to him and I'm like, dude, I don't think I can look like this cupid doll anymore. You know, that was the facade and now we've done the deed and I gotta be who she really is now. And he said, well, what do you mean? I said, the hair's got to change. The whole thing's got to change because that's not who she really is. I got to, you know, it's the look's different. The whole thing's different. I'm like getting it as I'm talking to him, right? And he looks at me and goes, all right. I mean, this is how much he trusts you. That's why every actor wants to work for him for a scale. And I looked at him and said, I can. Can change the look. I can go for it. He goes, if you can do it in 15 minutes. And we did. I just went in. I said, slick it over, slick it back, and darken my cheeks here, make it more angular. And you know, we just kind of threw it together. The clothes worked. The clothes still work. So that's how that all happened. And so much of that scene, the infamous. You know, frying pan scene, you know, so much of it was improv. Much to Judy and Patricia's chagrin, because they, you know, they're English and they don't like to improv that much. I, on the other hand, after working with Rob in Halloween, was so excited about the fact that we can improv and bring in all our own shit and stuff. I went, okay, well, you guys say the line. and I'll say most of the lines in improv. So it just worked, and the three of us just work. We just work together, don't we? All those colors just, yeah.
We all play really well off of each other.
Yeah.
It's very, Judy surprised me the most in that film. She was great. The one thing, you know, you talk about, you like to work, you know, you like to take on different roles. It's a job, it's what you love to do. Have there ever been any roles that you've read and you turned down, and then also in the same vein?
Yes, all the rest of the Helen films. They sent me the second one, and I'm sorry, I don't do porno yet.
Yet.
Yeah.
What about now? No, okay.
No, I do get fucked by that.
Now, have there been any roles that you've decided to turn down and then they go to somebody else and say that ends up becoming a very big role for somebody?
No.
Nothing like that?
I have better taste. When I read E.T. behind closed doors, you know, I called my agent and I said, you know, this isn't my film, I'm not really starring in it, but it's going to do a lot for this world. And I want to be a part of it. I knew that as soon as I read it. Of course, little did I know that here I would be 30-some years later, and that would be the iconic part of my career, pretty much. But no, the one part that I've always been really, really sad about is the movie of the week, Adam, about the little boy. I was doing a movie of the week with Don Deluise, and it overlapped one day, and we tried and tried and tried, and they wouldn't wait, and they wouldn't push, and so I finally just had to, you know, give up and go, it is what it is, and it catapulted Jo Beth into a lot of opportunities, you know, but I guess there's enough to go around. I'm still here.
Yes. Now, out of curiosity, are there any of your roles that you regret or just you weren't happy with?
You know, there's no roles that I really regret. It's the projects that the roles are in. Too numerous to even mention. You know, this whole freaking low budget bullshit thing that Melissa Gilbert did when she was president of SAG sold us all down the river.
Can you explain it a little bit?
Well, yeah. You know, now ultra low budget SAG film, and they relinquished a lot of what we used to get in our SAG contract to do these. Most people get paid $100 a day to come in and do them. I won't do them. I don't think anybody should do them. And I think that's why we have a lot of schlock out there. And people, seriously, I just did a film. I will not tell you what the name is. I just did a film, and the set closed down because half the checks bounced. Now, my agents are good agents, so they always get my money in escrow. So I called them and they went, well, you gotta stay on this empty because your money's an escrow. So I'm sitting there, as I always do, trying to help. I always go to, how can I help? And I thought, well, we've got the kids on the set. They've been here since 8 o'clock. So I went to the first AD, I use that term loosely. And I said, look, there's a big chunk in this one scene that's just between with me and the kids. We can shoot that while we're waiting for you guys to work all this stuff out.
Well, that's a good idea.
I said, well, I think we should shoot it now because the kids have been on the set since 8 o'clock. No, we're going to shoot it after dinner. I said, Now, I'm waiting for him to put this together, but the bells are not coming on. I looked at him and I said, so they've been here since 8, right? How long do you have them? Oh, we have till 5. What time's dinner? 5. And we're going to shoot them after dinner. And I waited, and I finally looked at him and I said, okay, you have to lose the kids at 5, and dinner's at 5, so we can't shoot them after. Oh, fuck, you're right. Right? Seriously, I'm over doing things where I know more than they do. I'm just over it. It doesn't honor your talent, you know? You're really throwing your pearls before swine. And I'm totally, I go out and help a lot of young filmmakers. I help a lot of young filmmakers, and then my name, if I think they know what they're doing and they have enough money to do it well. And you don't really need a lot of money to do it well, but you do have to know what the hell you're doing. And, you know, let's put on a show is not, that doesn't work. You gotta know, really know what you're doing and pull in favors and, you know, E.T. could be looked at as a low-budget film, the amount of money that we had to spend on E.T. But it sure was better than, what's the other one with the airplanes?
Oh, I was just thinking Mac and me.
But the other one that Steven did.
1941.
They had a huge frickin' budget. Look what happened with that. You know, it's not about the money, it's about the creativity and what you can do with it. But don't ask me, that's been in this business for 40 years, to walk on a set without my own dressing room. It can be a small dressing room. It doesn't have to be a, you know, a big trailer like I always had. But don't ask me to walk on without a dressing room in a private place of my own with my own bathroom. That's just disrespectful. You know? Don't ask your crew to work all day and not put any fucking food out for them. It's just disrespectful. You don't run a movie that way. If you don't have the money to take care of the respect for the people that are coming forward for you, then you shouldn't do the movie. And that's my thing.
Before this is over, speaking of directors who, at least I've heard, do respect the people that are working for them, I want to talk about your work with Joe Dante and The Howling.
Oh.
And do you still talk to Joe? Are you guys still friends?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, would you ever consider doing another movie with them?
Anything.
Yeah.
Anything. You know, the big problem is that Joe is so creative and he's got so many of his own ideas, you know, that the people in charge want to often take those away, and he just goes, take them on, you know, as Peter Jackson often did, you know, but after his huge late successes, he can do that now. I would work with Joe anytime. Love Joe. He tells me stories about what I was really like on The Howling, and I did not do that.
Like what? You have to tell us.
Oh my God. I guess I was a neurotic mess. Seriously. And we did this show together a few months ago, and he'd go, oh yeah, I just go to Chris and go, I don't know what to do with her. I said, really? I remember being really professional. He said, oh, you were really professional, Dee. You were just a neurotic mess because you would get into the part so much. You know? There was a, you remember the scene in The Howling where we're running to try to escape the werewolves, and the werewolves come and attack the car? Okay. Well, somebody thought they'd have a lot of fun and put a blank in the gun during rehearsal. You don't do that with Dee. So, we're in the rehearsal, and the, you know, we're practicing where the werewolves are going to hit it, and I know it should have been rehearsal, but I just get into it. And then the gun goes off. I think I screamed for an hour. I just lost it. I just, you know, because you're in La La Land. When you go into those places, you're just in La La Land. And then said, oh, Cujo, oh, you can't break the glass. Can't break. We've treated the glass, you can't break the glass, but you have to hit it really hard because we're going to shoot it in slow motion, right? Yeah, well, welcome to the adrenaline of an actor. So I'm there and I hit it, and I hit it the third time. I break the glass, and my arms from the impact go through the glass. Now I'm safety glass, but I still, you know, do I hear cut? Hell no. So Donna just keeps going. And part of my brain is going, okay, the way we rehearsed this, we were going to drag Danny out, but you can't drag Danny out because now there's glass. And that's why you see me doing that stupid waddle with him up in my arms, because I, part of me was D and part of me was her and part of me was C. Part, do I hear cut? Hell no. So I just keep running up to the house. Finally, I hear cut. Dan Blatt, our producer, runs over and says, oh my God, are you okay? Are you all right? And I said, why? And he said, Dee, look at your arms. What? You know? So the medic came and wrapped up everything in flesh bandage, you know, because we were going to go to the hospital. They ought to check. And Dee goes, you know, we don't have this location after today. You think you could do one more? High in your life when you get to be somebody else and totally commit to that, you know, like the frying pan scene. And Rob came over to me and I told you the other day and said, well, can you be really bad at this, you know, can we give you some swear words? And I said, only if I can say cunt. Because nobody's ever let me say cunt on a screen before. And he looks at me and starts having like, okay. I didn't think Dee Wallace would say cunt.
Oh my God. No mom for me too, you can say cunt.
Oh, please.
It's a crazy story.
Sometimes I just walk on his head and go, fuck. Okay, now we've got that over with. All right.
I wanna do it inside the actor studio. What is your favorite swear word, Dee?
Obviously, fuck.
What I want to do is before we're over.
Just I like Oy Vey too.
Okay.
I know I'm not sure.
I just wondered if any of your fans have any questions.
Jesus, I hope so.
Yeah. Okay.
I was wondering, did you ever film any alternate takes on Cujo where
never.
You died?
Never. We had a big discussion about it, and I said no. Not in movies in the 80s are we going to kill the kid at the end. Not after what we've taken him through. And there's going to be a lot of people that come see this movie that never read the book. And in the end, Stephen King wrote us and said, thank God you didn't kill the kid in the end of the movie. It was the most hate mail he's ever received in the history of his writing career. So it was never an option, not for me.
I thought one of the most powerful scenes in Howling was the very end when you as the newswoman go on set to reveal the whole reality.
Thank you.
And you begin to turn on screen as mm-hmm. the cameras are rolling and you know you see the tear coming out and you really communicated the pain of that moment. I thought very
thank
badly.
You.
Can you talk a little bit about that whole scene?
No matter what part I play, I try and find the place that makes them real. You know? Sonny had, in Lords of Salem, Sonny had to create this child for Satan. Because Satan was her father, her lifeline. And that's where I played the whole thing from. From the point of view of Karen, it was the truth. I have to show you the truth. That's my job in this life, is to show you the truth, to be the truth, to represent the truth. And that's what drove that whole last scene. And it was written verbally, pretty much closely to the way we did it. But when we got into rehearsing it for camera, you know, I said to Joe, this has to be a struggle. Up until the very last minute, this has to be a struggle because she doesn't want to give over to it. And she has given herself in front of the cameras to tell the truth. And I had to wear those 14 karat gold contacts. That's a lot of fun. And then Joe said, well, don't worry about the screen. We'll find a good screen and put it over. And I said, well, give me a shot anyway, right? And that's my screen that you hear. And they just kept repeating it and reverbing it. But that's my screen. So that was supposed to really be after you see, you know, the she-wolf at the end and she says, rare. That was supposed to be, we cut right to that, but when all the audiences came in, all the cards said, we want to see Dee Wallace as a werewolf. Well, back in those days, it was important, I guess, to have those things in your contract because I had it in my contract that my character would never appear as a werewolf. So I was shooting Cujo. Joe Dante calls me and goes, okay, so we've got a little problem. Everybody wants to see you as a werewolf and your contract says, no way. So what are we going to do? I said, Joe, I'm shooting Cujo. I can't. No, we don't need you. We just need your okay. I said, all right, but can you make her vulnerable? Can you make her different than the werewolves because she's fought so hard? And they came up with this Bambi werewolf, which is an animatronic. At the end, there's nobody in it. I think it was me.
Did you have a good experience working with Rob Bottin on that film?
Oh, God.
Was Rob?
You know, he was robbed. I'm sorry, I couldn't do the other panel with.
Totally understood. Yeah.
I just couldn't because I had such strong feelings. They had so much more money than we did. And I think the effects are not as good. And I just think Rob, he lived and breathed and had been like one guy helping him with those things. He was just, his dedication was just beyond what anybody should have asked of anybody on that set. And he's very quiet and he's very shy. That's why he doesn't do most of the shows. But he's a beautiful, talented professional.
There are a lot of fans that want to meet him, so if you speak to him, you should convince him.
I'm working on it.
Good.
I'd love to do one, you know, with a whole panel, like Rob and Joe and myself. Of course, Chris is gone, but Belinda.
I think you can make it happen, Dee. Talk to Joe and talk to Rob. Let's make this happen.
Okay.
I think you all agree with me.
Okay,
let's clap. We've got time for one more question. Anybody else have something? Yes.
Bowers is my maiden name, my family name, and Wallace was my first husband. But Bowers didn't sound nearly as nice and simple as Wallace. And nobody could say Deanna. It was either Diane or Dina or Deanne or something. So Deanna's my home name, but so I just shortened it, kept Dee Wallace. And then of course when I married Chris, it became Dee Wallace Stone, and I couldn't get anybody in the press to remember to use it. And then a few years ago, I thought I'm just gonna go back to Dee Wallace, and now I can't get him to not use it. Press.
Yes.
Well, so that's fine. That's that.
Thank you for being the most enchanting panelist ever.
Oh.
Thank you.